Steve, Professor Steven Pinker, Johnson Family Professor of Psychology at Harvard University, and a very distinguished visiting professor of this college. Stephen was with us last term, came and talked about his latest book, which is a remarkable, rather wonderful book, The Better Angels of Our Nature, and gave an interesting talk to our community. But I expect some of you will know better some of his other works on mind and language, the language instinct, and other books. We're delighted to have Steve with us, and over to you.
This lecture is going to be special, because at the end of the lecture, I am going to perform a miracle. This is true. If you can sit out the entirety of this lecture, you will witness me performing a miracle. In 1994, Francis Cricks, the co-discoverer of DNA, wrote a book that he titled The Astonishing Hypothesis, The Scientific Search for the Soul. The astonishing hypothesis is the notion that all of our experience, our perception, our thoughts, our memories, our emotions, our drives, our longings, our achings, consist of physiological activity in the tissues of the brain. And though I've been talking and thinking about the brain for decades, this is a hypothesis that still fills me with astonishment. I'm completely committed to the idea that it is true, but it is something that that still fills me with wonder. Why do I think it's true? Not because I am just trained in the tribe of scientists and it's part of our creed, but because there's an enormous amount of empirical evidence that it's true. For example, the phenomena of the soul, such as conscious experience, can be caused by an electrical current. In the 1930s, the Canadian neurosurgeon Wilder Penfield, while operating on the exposed brains of conscious patients, would stimulate the surface of the brain with an electrical current, and it would cause the person to undergo a vivid, lifelike experience indistinguishable from reality. We know that chemistry can have causal effects on the phenomena of experience, as we see in the phenomena of psychoactive drugs, both pharmaceutical and recreational. We know that if part of the brain is physically destroyed, if it's starved of oxygen because of a stroke, a part of mental life can disappear, and a stroke patient can be rendered unable to recognize a face or to make a deliberate decision. We know that surgery can affect the phenomena of the soul, as you will see in the next lecture, where I discuss the split brain surgery, in which a surgeon disconnects the two cerebral hemispheres by severing the corpus callosum, resulting in two consciousnesses co-inhabiting the same skull, as if the soul could be bisected with a knife. We have every reason to believe that the life and death of the body is equal to the life and death of the soul. That is, when the physiological activity of the brain ceases, then our consciousness goes out of existence. Now, you might say, how could we ever know this? We can't, although I would certainly be convinced otherwise if, say, a seance with Aunt Ethel leads her to reveal that she stored her jewels underneath the fourth floorboard in the third room on the second story, and you dig up the floorboard, and there it is. As far as we know, despite a number of fairly serious attempts to communicate with the souls of the dead more than a century ago, all of those attempts have failed. Also, if we thought that the phenomena of the mind were implemented by the brain, and we looked at the brain and we discovered it was made out of spam, that is, homogeneous tissue that seemed to be incapable of causing all of the complex phenomena that we associate with the mind, we would still be skeptical of the astonishing hypothesis. But in fact, a look at the brain, and this is the theme of this evening's lecture, shows that it is physically fully capable of shouldering the burdens of accounting for intelligence. The brain has been called the most complex object in the known universe. It has 100 billion neurons, or brain cells, interconnected by 100 trillion synapses, or connections. Every cubic millimeter of your brain contains 200,000 neurons. The theme of tonight's lecture, though, is to make this, the astonishing hypothesis, even more credible by showing mechanistically how the physical structure and activity of the brain could support the phenomena that we call intelligence. I'm going to address the question, how does neural tissue actually make us smart? It's one thing to say that if a patient suffers damage to a particular part of the brain, they can no longer recognize faces, and perhaps that part of the brain is specialized for face recognition. But it doesn't tell us how it does it. It just reduces a big miracle, namely, how does the brain make us smart, to a small miracle, namely, how does that patch of brain recognize faces? By drilling down to the level of neurons and neural circuitry, we can actually see how intelligence arises out of the physiological mechanisms of the brain. And how does neural tissue account for the contents of consciousness? When we see red as opposed to green, can that be explained by different patterns of activity in the brain? And that's what I will attempt to show you. Well, the hero of our story is depicted over here. This is a real neuron grown on grown in culture. It's actually quite astonishing to anyone who has been teaching psychology and brain science for a number of decades that what used to be only depicted by artists' renditions can now, thanks to advances in technology, be actually seen in three dimensions and color. So this is not an artist's rendition, although it has more detail than most artists' renditions. This is a real live neuron. This is, again, a real picture. It's called a brain bow, developed by my colleagues at Harvard, Josh Sains and Joel Lichtman. And it's a technique that can make neurons stand out against their background in fluorescent color. The The orange and yellow spaghetti that you're seeing here consists of one neuron. This is a slice through a part of the brain called the hippocampus. This is the cell body of the neuron. All of these tendrils here are the input fibers going into that neuron, and though you can't see it underneath the tissue, all of these tangles over here consist of the output fibers of that same single neuron. Multiply what you're seeing here by 100 billion, and you get start to get a feel for the complexity of the brain. Here is a schematic diagram of a neuron. Like all cells of the body, the neuron has a nucleus. That's where the chromosomes live. It's got a cell body. That is the physical plant of the neuron. It supports all the activity that keeps a neuron alive. These are the input fibers to the neuron called dendrites, after the Greek word for tree. This is the output fiber called the axon. Many axons are surrounded by these fatty sausage-like cells that give the white matter its white appearance, and I'll talk about that in the third of the lectures. Here are the outputs of the neuron, the axon terminals. Now, the transmission of information through a neuron, it took thousands of years to discover what was really happening, because since neurons are tubes, and since they're filled with fluid, it is tempting to think of neural transmission in hydraulic terms. But what it means is that whereas electricity travels at something pretty close to the speed of light, neural transmission is very slow, on the order of 2 to 200 miles per hour, compared to electricity, which is in the order of 670 million miles per hour. Mental processes, as measured by a psychologist, that is the whole brain operating together, operate in the order of tens of milliseconds, millisecond being a thousandth of a second, so this is hundredths of a second. We experience this as we, for example, drop a cup and will our hand to grab it and are frustrated as our hand just won't respond in time to catch it. That reminds us of how slow neural transmission is. Needless to say, electronic processes such as what happens in your computer or iPhone are orders of magnitude faster, on the order of nanoseconds, billionths of a second. Also, another difference between neurons and man-made signal processors is that in an axon, the output fiber of a neuron, the energy is not conducted by the axon. The energy is in the axon. And neurotransmission can be analogized to more like lighting a trail of gunpowder than transmitting energy along a wire. So how does it actually take place? Excuse me. Here is the cell membrane that divides the inside of the neuron from the outside of the neuron. And the simplest way to think about a neuron is to consider it as a bag of low-sodium chicken soup immersed in a bucket of salt water. The salt water is the extracellular fluid. Salt is sodium chloride, NaCl. When it's dissolved, you have a bunch of positively charged ions, that is, the sodium ions, and a bunch of negatively charged ions, the chloride ions. Inside the cell, on the interior of the cell membrane, you've got, I said it's low-sodium chicken soup, so there's not a whole lot of sodium inside the cell. If your doctor puts you on a low-sodium diet and you buy a salt substitute, what does it have? It has potassium chloride. And potassium, like sodium, is dissolves into positively charged ions. So over here you've got a bunch of potassium ions. Then these big globules here are protein molecules, and they are negatively charged. If you, you've got a bunch of positive and negative ions outside the cell, you've got a bunch of positive and negative ions inside the cell. On average, the result gives you minus 70 millivolts, thousands of a volt, as the potential across the cell membrane. That is, if you were to take a voltmeter, the kind your electrician uses, stick one electrode inside the cell, one of them outside of the cell, the needle will read minus 70. However, the cell membrane that bounds a neuron is studded with these complicated gizmos called channels, with little gates that can open and close to let these ions through. And in general, they can open and close depending on the voltage that lies across the membrane, which is ordinarily minus 70 millivolts. When the voltage changes, when it flips from negative to positive, and I'll show you how that happens, the sodium channel opens, allowing sodium ions to come through. So here's, let me go back to, here we go. If the sodium channel opens, then these ions, which are just ricocheting around, following Brownian motion, will work their way through against the concentration gradient, and you get sodium starting to infiltrate into the inside of the cell. Salt leaks in. When it does, sodium is positively charged. That little bit of membrane that is now contaminated on the inside with all of that sodium will flip its polarity, that is, it will depolarize, going up to 30 millivolts from negative to positive. When that happens, the potassium channels open, and potassium exits the cell to restore the voltage across the cell back to minus 70 millivolts. That's what happens at a local part of the membrane. If I were to have my two electrodes of my voltmeter in one spot of the cell, what I would see over time is the flip from minus 70 millivolts to plus 30, and then back again. Now, crucially, once that happens in one part of the membrane, it then sets off a chain reaction whereby the sodium channels open in an adjacent patch of the membrane. Sodium pours into the adjacent part of the membrane, neutralized when potassium flows out. This is a very simplified diagram of how that works. So simplified, it comes from a textbook that assumes that students don't know the word ion. So these are plus atoms rush in. That is to say sodium. Plus atoms go back out, that is to say potassium. Now this gate opens and atoms, that is sodium ions, rush in. Then the potassium ions go back out, and the process repeats itself at successive patches along the axon. This is a slightly more sophisticated textbook. It's the one that I use at Harvard, which shows the same thing where Na plus and K plus are used instead of plus atoms, but it's the same process. Sodium goes in, potassium goes out. This graph here, unlike the one that I showed before, which is at a single spot on the membrane and plots the change in voltage over time, this one plots length along the axon, and it plots the voltage over space at any given time. So here we have a part of the membrane where nothing much is happening. That's our minus 70 resting potential. Here, this part, we've got our sodium rushing in. Here we've got our potassium rushing out. But that wave moves across the membrane so that over time, if I were to show this to you as a movie, these two peaks would flow from left to right. These, by the way, are also called spikes, because if you actually see them on a oscilloscope tracing, they're much pointier than what I've shown, and the entire process is called an action potential. That is the basic way in which information is transmitted along the length of an axon, and note that what is physically happening is not the flow of electrons along a wire, like in a electricity, but rather the flow of ions in and out of the cell. Now you might, there's one part of the story, by the way, that is incomplete. You might be wondering, well, why doesn't the inside of the cell just fill up with salt, with sodium, and all the potassium leave, and then the process is not sustainable? The answer is that there are two metabolic processes called the sodium pump and the potassium pump that push the sodium back out of the cell, preventing it from being poisoned by all of that sodium, and grab potassium to bring it back in. Basic law of chemistry is that it takes lots of energy to push molecules against a concentration gradient. One of the reasons that your brain is so metabolically expensive, why it's so greedy for energy, one of the things that will kill you if your brain doesn't get enough oxygen and glucose is that there's not enough energy to power the sodium and potassium pumps to prevent your neurons from filling up with salt and dying. What happens when it gets to the end? Well, then it reaches a synapse. This is the end of one neuron. This is the beginning of another. And the physical nature of the process changes. This is an artist's rendition. It is not a real photograph. But what we have over here, the end of an axon is called the axon terminal, or the bouton, because it's kind of a button. Here we've got a dendrite, an input fiber, and it's got a spine, literally called a spine, which makes the synapse with the output of the preceding neuron. This is a real photograph of a number of axon terminals, of terminal boutons, something I was astonished to see because I'd only seen artist's rendition until it was possible to actually image it. And here, back to our neuron grown in culture, you see several hundred dendritic spines, which is where the synapses occur. At the when an action potential reaches an axon terminal at the end, the following train of events happen. The axon terminal is filled with little baggies filled with chemicals called vesicles, synaptic vesicles. The chemicals that they are filled with are called neurotransmitters. And through a bit of molecular wizardry that I will not explain, when the voltage potential changes, when the action potential reaches the end of the neuron, these synaptic vesicles fuse with the presynaptic membrane. Here's a close-up. These baggies kind of barf their contents into this little gap between the axon and the dendrite. The molecules are disgorged into this cleft, and they diffuse across the synaptic cleft, this gap filled with fluid between one neuron and another. Note that the neurotransmitter molecules are depicted with complicated shapes. That's because they fit into a special slot, kind of like a lock and key, in special channels in the postsynaptic membrane. When they do, when the chemical engages the receptor, a gate opens, allowing sodium ions into the across the postsynaptic membrane, initiating the same process in the next neuron in the chain. So that's how information is transmitted, and I call it information because its physical basis changes entirely, a change in voltage along the length of the axon, then a chemical process at the synapse, but it's the same information that's transmitted from one neuron to another. You've heard of a number of neurotransmitters if you read articles on neuroscience in the newspaper. They include norepinephrine or noradrenaline, related to the adrenaline that courses through your arteries when you are emotionally aroused. Acetylcholine, dopamine, serotonin, glutamate, and GABA are some examples of chemicals used by the nervous system as neurotransmitters. Now, the reason that the change from an electrical signal to a chemical signal is significant is that this chemical process allows a point of infiltration for psychoactive drugs. Why do drugs make you happy or excited or hallucinate and so on? It's because they interact with this chemical stage of neural information processing. And here is you've all heard of Prozac, Zoloft, Paxil, that whole class of antidepressant drugs. Here's a simplified version of how they work. Prozac is also called an SSRI. That stands for Selective Serotonin Reuptake Inhibitor, which a name which actually explains how it works. Serotonin is a neurotransmitter that's involved in positive emotion. I mentioned that when a action potential reaches the end of an axon, the synaptic vesicles disgorge their contents into the synaptic cleft. What prevents the synaptic cleft from just getting saturated with, say, serotonin, and the axon terminal from being exhausted? Well, again, you need a slower process that reverses this disgorging. Namely, there are mechanisms that recycle the serotonin, that slurp it back out from the synaptic cleft. What Prozac does is it inhibits that reuptake process. So instead of slurping up the serotonin too quickly, leaving none in the synaptic cleft to stimulate the postsynaptic neuron, Prozac allows all of that serotonin to hang around in that synaptic cleft longer and at higher concentration. That means there is more stimulation of the postsynaptic neuron, and if we're talking about a circuit that makes you happy, it means there is more juice that makes you happy. Now, I should add that this is the standard theory of how Prozac works. It is probably not a completely correct theory for a number of reasons, among them that it takes several weeks for Prozac to work. The theory doesn't predict that in a simple way. But this just the reason I introduced this is that it explains how the mere ingestion of a molecule can physiologically change your mood, and it does it because the nature of synaptic transmission is that it is a chemical process, and hence one where chemicals can affect how they work. According to what I've said so far, a neuron synapses on another neuron, it excites it, causes that whole action potential process to happen all over again. Well, what's to prevent the entire brain from running away in a positive feedback loop? So neuron stimulates neuron stimulates neuron stimulates neuron, the whole brain kind of blows up in a massive epileptic seizure. One of the reasons is that many of the synapses don't excite the postsynaptic cell, that is, cause it to fire at a higher rate, but rather inhibit it, cause it to fire at a lower rate. And it is crucial both to the fact that the brain doesn't just explode in a positive runaway feedback loop, but also, as we'll see, it's crucial to the way that neural circuits work, do intelligent things, that there also be inhibitory synapses. A anatomical fact is that whereas the excitatory synapses take place on the dendritic spines of dendrites, the inhibitory synapses consist of axon terminals that synapse directly on the cell body, giving a kind of diffuse inhibition by, rather than depolarizing the postsynaptic cell, they hyperpolarize it. That is, they make its voltage even more negative, so it's got more of a hill to climb in firing. How does having 100 billion of them in our head actually get us to do smart things?
Well, the process must begin when a neuron in the brain responds reliably to something in the world, so we can see, perceive, think thoughts that are about something. And the simplest way in which that happens is by a neural circuit that is sometimes called a feature detector. That is a part of the sensory brain that responds to a simple feature in the world. Feature detectors were discovered by David Hubel and Torsten Wiesel, for which they won the Nobel Prize. And I'm going to show you a rather charming explanation of how they serendipitously came upon their discovery. Now, when Hubel and Wiesel started, it was well known that the rods and cones in the eye responded to pinpoints of light, and that in simpler animals, the brain also responded to little polka dots of light. Let me just show you what Hubel and Wiesel discovered. And I hope this will be loud enough. You can hear it. It's David Hubel who's narrating it. By the way, the way that neurophysiology in its simplest form works is that the neurophysiologist will inhale a single neuron with a microelectrode, feed the voltage signal into an amplifier and a speaker. So those action potentials that I talked about hypothetically, you can actually hear. Each one is a little pop. And if a neuron fires at a slow rate, it goes at its resting rate, it'll go pop, 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 pop. When a neuron is excited, it'll go brrrr, and what you are hearing is literally those depolarizations that I showed in the graph.
We started working, Torsten and I, in the late 50s. We set up our first experiments, and they didn't go well because at the beginning we couldn't make the cells fire at all. We'd shine lights all over the screen, and nothing seemed to work. And rather by accident, one day, we were shining small spots, either white spots or black spots, onto the screen, and we found that the black dot seemed to be working in a way that at first we couldn't understand until we found that it was the process of slipping the piece of glass into the projector, which swept a line, a very faint, precise, narrow line across the retina, and every time we did that, we'd get a response. And even more than that, the line produced a response as it swept across the screen in one direction, but not in the reverse direction. Of course, that could have simply been an oddball cell. We didn't know whether we'd ever find another such cell. But after some weeks or months, it became pretty clear that most of the cells that we encountered in the visual cortex demanded just that kind of stimulus. Although from one cell to the next, the orientation varied, a number of other things differed. The line was the important thing.
Okay, so by accident, the edge of the slide led them to discover what you can think of as moving line detectors in the primary visual cortex, in this case of the cat, but we know that humans have them too. The ability of a single neuron in the brain to detect a line is not inherently mysterious. They showed a simple wiring diagram of how that could work. This is your retina, or literally the cat's retina. Here are a bunch of rods and cones. If you imagine, say, a line of rods and cones feeding into a circuit that ends up in a single cell and is inhibited by rods and cones that surround it, you have basically built yourself a simple little line detector that can be carried out by a single neuron. I'm going to say more about that soon. Once you have the power to wire neurons into circuits, then you get neural networks. This is a brainbow image of some real neural circuit networks that I'm just illustrating to remind you physically of what we're dealing with. If you are following me so far and you can see how we can build a brain that responds to a simple feature like a line, well, we think about more complicated things than lines. How do you build complex concepts out of simple concepts? Well, the interesting discovery about the physiological capabilities of neurons is that it isn't hard to show how they can build complex things out of simple things, namely how they can implement simple logical combinations. So let's take the complex concept kosher from the Jewish dietary laws, which may be defined as meat is kosher if it comes from an animal that chews its cud and has cloven hooves, or has fins and has scales. So if you are willing to grant me the existence of a cud-chewing detector, a cloven-hoof detector, a fin detector, and a scale detector, then you can build this rather subtle concept of kosher out of a bunch of ands and ors and nots. So if you can explain how neurons can compute and, or, and not, you've gone part of the way to showing how a brain can compute complicated concepts out of the simple kinds of concepts that perhaps could be done by the feature detectors. So here's the basic idea. Here's a simple neural network. These are a bunch of input neurons, so the information flows from the bottom of the screen to the top of the screen. Here is an output neuron. I'm going to use arrows here to illustrate excitatory synapses, dots to indicate inhibitory synapses. Synapses vary in their strength. That is, how much the an action potential coming in is effective at increasing the firing rate of the postsynaptic neuron. And I can't crowd them all over here at the synapses, so I just spread them out over here. Let's say that the strength of synapses varies from 0 to 1 for excitatory synapses, and from 0 to minus 1 for inhibitory synapses. The simplest form of neural computation works as follows. Each one of these input neurons is firing at a certain rate. You multiply the firing rate by the strength of the synapse. The outgoing neuron sums the weighted the firing rates weighted by the synaptic strength. If they exceed a threshold, the cell will increase its firing rate, otherwise the cell does nothing. Well, it turns out that that's all you need to compute and, or, and not. You can build an AND gate out of neurons as follows. So what does AND mean? Well, P and Q, that statement that I just said, P and Q, that is true if the statement P is true and also if the statement Q is true. So what we want is if this turning on represents P is true, if that turning on represents Q is true, we want to build a neuron that turns on when and only when both of these guys are active. How do we do that? Easy. If the synaptic strength is of each one is 0.4, if P is true, which means that that neuron is on, but Q is false, meaning that that neuron is off, you get, let's say it's firing at a rate of 1. 1 times 0.4 is 0.4. 0 times 0.4 is 0. 0.4 times 0 is 0.4. That is less than the threshold of the cell, 0.5, so it will fail to fire if only one of its two inputs is on. Symmetrically, it will fail to fire if that one is on and that one is off, which represents the state of knowledge Q is true but P is false. If P is true and Q is true, which we represent by this neuron being active and that neuron being active, the P detector and the Q detector, 1 times 0.4 plus 1 times 0.4 is 0.8. 0.8 exceeds 0.5, and so that neuron will fire when and only when its two inputs fire, therefore implementing everything that we need to be an AND gate, or computing the AND function. You can pretty easily see that if a circuit was wired slightly differently, so that the synaptic strengths were 0.6, then all it would take is one of these two to be active. That would lead to an aggregate neural input that would exceed the threshold of the output cell. And so this cell, the P or Q detector, would be on if either the P cell was firing or the Q cell was firing. So we have a mechanical implementation of orness. Now imagine a cell that whose threshold is zero, which is to say that it is spontaneously active. If it doesn't get any input at all, it fires away. And we have a neuron that has an inhibitory synapse, minus one. Well, when the input is on, the output will be off, and vice versa. What does not P mean? Not P simply means I'm on when my input is off, or I'm true when my constituent is false, and vice versa. And so here we have a mechanical implementation of a not detector. Now, you might object, well, human thought does not consist just of crunching logical combinations like the definition of kosher that I just indicated. A lot of human cognition is fuzzy and probabilistic. So a vegetable, we all know that celery is a vegetable, but is parsley a vegetable? Is garlic a vegetable? Is ketchup a vegetable? That was actually an issue in American politics when the Republicans tried to cut the school budget while adhering to dietary guidelines, so they reclassified ketchup as a vegetable in order to save money while adhering to the letter of the law. Anyway, you can have debates. There's different degrees of vegetablehood, but there are it's easy to have neural circuits that can compute them. In fact, many neurophysiologists would argue easier to do it for graded fuzzy concepts than crisp all or none concepts. So if what makes a vegetable is having any subset of vegetable stereotypical features, like being green, being leafy, that helps, being crunchy, that helps. If it got up and started to walk away, presumably that would count against its vegetablehood. So you have a inhibitory synapse from a mobile detector. If it, you could lift it with a magnet, presumably not a vegetable, so you have another inhibitory synapse. The aggregated sum of vegetable stereotypical and vegetable anti-stereotypical features would determine this firing rate continuously, indicating your degree of confidence that something or other is a vegetable. How much can you build out of these simple circuits, and or not, and how much? Well, here's a simple model of reading, of word recognition. Down here, we have neurons, our feature detectors of the kind that Hubel and Wiesel discovered in cats. You can wire them up with a bunch of excitatory and inhibitory synapses, following the logic of logic gates and so on, to give you a detector that responds only to a bunch of shapes that form the configuration of an A, or an N, or a T, or a G. Then over here you've got word detectors, words that are excited by the letters that make them up, inhibited by the letters that aren't found in them, and that therefore reliably respond to the presence of entire English words. And I should emphasize, by the way, that when a neural modeler writes words like able and trap and train in the neuron, those are just mnemonics for the benefit of us, the scientists. As far as the neural network is concerned, there's nothing that actually reads these words. They just fire or they don't fire. But this just reminds us of what we're looking at. Now, does the brain actually have single neurons that can respond, presumably as a result of these neural networks, to complex concepts? Well, monkeys can't read, so you can't look for detectors for the word trip in the brain of a monkey. But monkeys are very, very interested in the faces of other monkeys. And here's another video clip, this one by the neurophysiologist Mortimer Mishkin, on the discovery of face detectors in the temporal lobe of monkeys.
They can record from single neurons in part of the inferior temporal lobe, and these neurons will be activated by faces better than by any other kind of stimulus that they can present. Not only will they be activated by faces, but if the faces are distorted in certain ways, the neurons will not respond.
As we watch, we can hear single cells in the inferior temporal lobe of monkeys reacting to a single monkey face. The cell only fires if the face is at the right angle and is not distorted.
Okay. Now, I have to emphasize at this point that the picture that I've painted so far, where you've got a bunch of neural networks feeding into each other, starting with feature detectors, and then eventually culminating in a single neuron for a complex concept like a word or a face is not the only or even the primary way that the brain represents information. And there is a debate among neurophysiologists to the extent that the brain uses local representations, that is, one neuron stands for a concept, and distributed representations, where a pattern of neurons represents a concept. The local representation theory is sometimes satirized by the term grandmother cell, the hypothetical neuron in your brain that responds when and only when you're looking at your grandmother. It was augmented by the putative yellow Volkswagen detector. This was intended as a kind of reductio ad absurdum of the idea that there could be one neuron in your brain for every concept that you have. Although it turns out, I don't know if anyone has discovered a grandmother cell, but it turns out that we do have, or at least some of us have, Jennifer Aniston detectors. This was actually discovered in, experiment done on a conscious neurosurgery patient, brain exposed, electrode impaling a single neuron. So even though the grandmother cell was introduced as a term of ridicule, it turns out that we probably have them. However, you can go too far, and it is not the case that every concept has its dedicated neuron. A distributed representation would be one where, if you were thinking of your grandmother, for example, that neuron, that neuron, that neuron, and that neuron would be active. If you were thinking about Queen Elizabeth, then that neuron, that neuron, that neuron, and that neuron would be active. And the difference among concepts would not be that every individual that you know about gets his or her own neuron, but rather different subsets. And if you have, presumably representing different features, size and shape of face and so on, here I have a slightly different kind of neural network called an autoassociator. That is, every neuron is connected to every other neuron, and frequently co-occurring patterns lead to strengthened synapses, so that if you detect a subset of the features that belong to a concept, the rest of them turn on automatically. That's a whole other... all of this kind of debate is what constitutes the subfield of computational neuroscience or neural network modeling. Okay, well, first I talked about the physiology of a neuron, how a neuron literally works. Then I talked about neural networks, how in theory assemblies of neurons connected by excitatory and inhibitory synapses could compute interesting logical functions and concepts. Now I'm going to show a number of examples in which features of neural wiring that we know about through electrophysiology actually explain certain aspects of your conscious experience. Okay? These three wiring features are called lateral inhibition, opponent process circuitry, and habituation, and I'll explain each one in turn. But there is a common denominator. All of them get the brain to respond to differences and contrasts in the world rather than steady states. So if you were living in a world that was uniform gray, none of these circuits would respond, even though light was pouring in. What they do is they attune you to differences in space, differences in time. And I'll explain how that works. Okay, lateral inhibition. This was the first feature of a neural circuit that was actually discovered in a living organism. And it works as follows. Imagine that each one of you is connected to all of your neighbors. And when you get stimulated by my laser pointer, I won't actually do it because my aim isn't that good and I don't want to blind anyone, you do two things in conveying in response to this stimulation. One is you stand up. The other is you push all your neighbors down. Okay? So imagine what would happen then as one of you was stimulated, as a whole bunch of you were stimulated. Okay, that is lateral inhibition wiring. Let me just show you what that consists of anatomically. Here's your eyeball. Just to remind you, I'll go over this in the other two lectures. Vision begins when light bounces off an object, is focused by the cornea and lens, forming an image on your retina, layer of light-sensitive cells. The rods and cones convert light into neural impulses, which are then conveyed along a set of ganglion cells that exit in the blind spot and form the optic nerve, which then goes to the visual parts of the brain. Here is a patch of your retina. These Rs are receptors, that is rods and cones. Let's assume they're cones. Here we've got an intermediate level of tissue in your retina. Here's your ganglion cell, which carries a signal to the brain. And here's how lateral inhibition works. The artist here has drawn an oval around a bullseye of cones. Now that doesn't actually exist in the retina, just the artist, for our convenience, has drawn an oval around them. Why those? Because all of those feed with excitatory synapses to a cell called the bipolar cell, that doesn't matter, but it feeds into another excitatory synapse into the ganglion cell, which carries a signal to the brain. So in that little bit of your retina, anything, whenever it gets stimulated by light, it causes an increase in signal activity to the brain. Now the artist has also drawn a donut around that bullseye, and here, also studded with rods and cones, but here, notice how the wiring diagram differs. It goes through a kind of cell called the horizontal cell, that's not important. However, the output from the horizontal cells connects to this bipolar cell by an inhibitory synapse. Here the artist uses a flat line rather than a dot, but we're still talking about inhibition. And it's the sum of all of the excitatory inputs from the bullseye and the inhibitory inputs from this surround that get combined, smushed together, and that get sent via the ganglion cell to the brain. If I were just to take a flashlight and bathe this entire area in light, would the ganglion cell fire? Well, not necessarily, because while it would be stimulated by all of the receptors in the center, it would also be inhibited by all the cells in the surround, and they would pretty much cancel each other out. We're going back to my analogy of you guys. For one of you, if you followed the rule that I just mentioned, namely when light hits you, stand up, push down your neighbors. Well, you're all bathed in light. You're all going to be trying to stand up. You're all going to have neighbors that are pushing you down. You're probably not going to stand up very high. However, let's say I were to zap you with a narrowly focused beam of light that just illuminated a few of you. Well, the guy at the center still wouldn't be able to stand up very tall because he's being pushed down by his neighbors. But the ones at the edge between light and darkness, they are being stimulated by light. They don't have a neighbor pushing them down because the neighbor is in darkness. Those are the ones who are going to stand up tall. Going back out of our analogy, back to the actual visual system, if you had a beam, a bright spot that stimulated only the center, surrounded by inky blackness, that would send the ganglion cell screaming its head off, because it would be getting excitation from the center, it would be not be getting any inhibition from the surround, and so it would be firing at its maximum rate. Okay? That's lateral inhibition. Now, of course, your retina does not just consist of one little, tiny little bullseye. It is peppered with rods and cones and these little circuits over its entire surface. Here we have a whole line of receptors, rods or cones in your eye. Here we've got a bunch of ganglion cells, and here we're just using the symbolic notation of arrow means excitatory, polka dot here means inhibitory, and as you can see, every receptor excites a ganglion cell connected to it while inhibiting its neighbors, dot dot arrow. So if you have a whole array of these, now what's going to happen when they get stimulated by a pattern? For example, this pattern over here. Here we have space left to right. This is a spotlight. If we plot light, and this, by the way, we're plotting just the physics of light. We're not talking about the brain at all. This is just what we're stimulating the retina with. So going from left to right, plotting the intensity of the light, we've got black, 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 white, 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 black, 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 black. White spotlight, black field. What is going to be the output of all of these ganglion cells that get sent to the brain as a result? Is it going to be off, 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 on, 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 off, 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 off? No. Lateral inhibition changes the nature of the signal. It does some signal processing or analog computation. What's going to happen is that the ganglion cells that respond to that part of the visual field are going to get excited by the light hitting their respective rods and cones, but they're also going to be inhibited by their neighbors, just like you guys being pushed down at the same time you're trying to stand up. The ones at the edge, the one at the edge, though, has the advantage of being stimulated by the light hitting its rod or cone, not being inhibited by the rod or cone that is sending an inhibitory connection to it. So it is free to kind of scream its head off. Conversely, if we now look at the ganglion cells that respond to the dark part of the visual field, the ones over here in the middle of darkness are not being excited. On the other hand, they're not being inhibited. So they're kind of halfway in between. The bit of darkness that is adjacent to the bright spot is not being excited, and it is being inhibited. It's being pushed below its resting rate. Therefore, the entire pattern of output is this kind of Batman figure, where the edges of the spot are firing at a greater rate than average, the edges of darkness are firing at a lower rate than average, and the ones in the middle of lightness or in the middle of darkness aren't really doing anything very interesting. Now, it turns out that that bit of circuitry, which has been established just by poking electrodes in the visual system of simple animals, can account for a number of visual illusions that we, an entire human being, can report from our conscious experience. And there are three classic psychological phenomena known before anyone knew how a neuron worked. Back in, they were in psychology textbooks in the days of William James, that can be explained by the knowing how this bit of wiring works. So the first are called Mach bands. Now, if you look at this pattern of stripes, if you look very closely at the lightness of each one of them, you might notice that perceptually they don't appear uniform. Now, so each one, do you notice, let's take this guy over here. Does it look a little bit brighter along this edge and a little bit darker along this edge?
Mm-hmm.
Most people will report that. Likewise over here, even though it's uniform gray from edge to edge, you should see a little bit of brightness over here, a little bit of darkness over here. And the reason is that just like that Batman output as a result of a spot input, if you were to plot physical intensity over space, you'd get this perfect staircase. But feed those intensities through a lateral inhibition network, and you get this spiky pattern over here, this sawtooth, which we perceive as a little lighter than on this edge, a little darker on this edge. So those are called Mach bands, discovered by the physicist Ernst Mach. And here is a, a blown-up demonstration, a reminder of why it happens. For A gets a ganglion cell, that is a neuron that feeds the brain, gets stimulated by all this lightness over here, but on the other hand gets inhibited by all this lightness over here, whereas this one here at the edge gets stimulated by the light hitting its rods and cones. It is not inhibited by its neighbors, because its neighbors are sitting in a slightly darker area, and so it is perceived as brighter. Conversely, a ganglion cell responding to this portion of the visual field does not get much excitation. It also doesn't get much inhibition. This one over here does not get much excitation, and it does get some inhibition by its neighbors, and so it will be driven below its resting rate. It will be perceived as a bit darker than the background. This is called a herring grid and has a similar explanation. The illusion consists, this will be stronger or weaker depending on where you're sitting, but you might see ghostly little gray spots at the intersections, all of the intersections except the one that you're looking at for interesting reasons, but we'll ignore that for now. And the explanation is similar. The reason that you get, if you're looking over here, you should see gray spots here, 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 and here, is that for ganglion cells that respond to an area at the intersection of these city blocks, they are getting excited by the rods and cones feeding them. They're getting inhibited from four sides, and so they're going to appear a little darker than the rest of the white, hence gray. The ones in the middle of the block are only getting inhibited from two sides rather than four sides. They are not getting inhibited as much. They are firing at a higher rate. They are perceived as white or white. And that's why the intersections seem gray, whereas the middle of the city blocks seem white. Here's another version of it. You might be able to see, if this is working, faint diagonal gray lines. Do you see them? Hope so. Again, it may depend on where you're sitting. And this is my favorite. I got this as an email attachment. Here the artist has amplified the effect, and you can actually figure out why if you work through it. But here you should see lots and lots of black polka dots, none of which exist. Each one of these intersections is white-white. And as you move your eyes around, the spots that are black and white should change. I'll just give you a hint as to why that is true, and I won't explain it, but you can probably figure it out after I tell you the following fact. In the fovea, the center of your visual field, the ganglion cells and the rods and cones line up pretty much one-to-one. Each ganglion cell has a teensy-weensy little bit of the world that it looks at, which means that it can respond to very fine differences in space. In the periphery of your visual field, you've got massive fan-in where a vast number of rods and cones feed a single ganglion cell. So in the periphery, your brain is seeing the smeared combination of a huge patch of visual field all feeding into one ganglion cell and discarding fine differences. Okay. The second effect, this is called simultaneous contrast, also explicable in terms of lateral inhibition. I don't know how well this one works, but I'll show you a slightly better one. The idea is that these polka dots here, which are all objectively the same shade of gray, this one should look brighter than that one. This is a slightly better one. Does it work, actually? Mm-hmm. That is, does this polka dot look lighter than that polka dot? Mm-hmm. Okay, I can show you that they are actually objectively the same. People are always skeptical as to whether the artist in psych textbook illusions actually kind of puts a thumb on the scale to make it look better than it is. But this is just to prove to you that they really are objectively the same. Okay? Likewise, if I swap them, when you swap them, now this one should look darker than that one. Okay, so why do we have lateral inhibition? Natural selection wire up the eyes of most organisms this way? Well, basically, it's a way of ignoring what is constant across the visual field and paying attention to changes as you move across the visual field, which is another way of saying edges. So here we've got, say, a rose, and the idea is that if we look at this part of the visual field, it's like green, 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 kind of boring, 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 boring. But when you shift from green to pink, the brain takes notice. Something interesting is happening at that part of space. Namely, that's where leafy backdrop leaves off and rose begins. Likewise, inside the rose, it's pink, boring, pink, boring, pink, boring, pink, boring, until you get to another edge where pink gives way to dark green. That is worth paying attention to. That's where rose leaves off, background begins. So there's a sense in which your brain is converting from a sense of lightness, a set of lightnesses, to a bunch of detectors for the images. Have any of you played in Photoshop? You might notice that there is a filter called Unsharp Mask, which counterintuitively makes your images sharper. Unsharp mask actually works very, very similarly to lateral inhibition in the eyes, and it's a way of enhancing contrast at edges, make your fuzzy pictures look sharper. Okay, there are two other features of neural circuitry which also respond to differences in the world and which also can mechanistically account for differences in your conscious experience of the visual world. One feature is called opponent process circuitry, and it makes the brain responsive to differences in quality, light, dark, red, green, hot, cold, moving left, moving right. And the other is called habituation, which makes you respond to differences over time. That is, same, 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 different, you notice the change. Here's how they work. Okay, opponent process circuits, it's also a widespread feature of neural wiring throughout the animal kingdom. It works as follows. You've got two inputs to one neuron, one output, that themselves respond to qualitatively different aspects of a stimulus. You can see this feature of wiring across all of the senses. So you might have, say, a heat detector in your skin that feeds into a neuron, and a detector of cold that feeds into the same neuron, one of them exciting the neuron, the other inhibiting the neuron. Likewise, you might have I will now show you, the cones of the eye, that is the receptors that respond to daylight, come in three different sensitivities. You have a cone that's most responsive to red light, to green light, and to blue light. If you ever do photo printing in color, you know that you need three ink cartridges, or if you look very, very carefully at your computer screen or your TV screen, you'll see that there are triplets of dots, red, green, and blue. The reason that the magical number is three whenever it comes to color is that there are three kinds of cone in the eye. And the designers of printers and TV screens are basically capitalizing on the fact that there are three and no more than three different color inputs to the eye. But crucially, the red, green, and blue cones do not send three kinds of signals to the brain. Before it gets to the brain, those signals are combined in the following way. Take this ganglion cell here. Again, a ganglion cell is the cell that carries information from your eyeball out through the optic nerve into your visual brain. This ganglion cell here gets excitatory input from a red cone, but it gets via an interneuron, a neuron in between, inhibitory input from a green cone. What does that mean? It means that this ganglion cell is not a red detector, it's not a green detector, it's a degree of greenness versus redness detector. It means that when it is stimulated by red light, or it doesn't get much green light, it's going to increase its activity level, and you see that as redness. Conversely, if it does not get much red input, but it gets a lot of green input, its firing rate will be below the threshold, and you will experience that as greenness. Likewise, you've got a second kind of ganglion that gets excited by the blue cone, inhibited by the red and green cones, which together mix to give you yellow. The result is that this kind of input to the brain is a relative blueness versus yellowness detector. When it is excited, it makes you see blue. When it is inhibited, it makes you see yellow. But so crucially, what opponent process circuitry does is it gives you a continuum where the positive side, that is excitation, makes you experience one sensory quality. That same neuron, when it is driven below its resting rate, makes you experience the opposite sensory quality. Now, if you combine the lateral inhibition, that is, you excite your output, you inhibit your neighbor's output, with opponent process, namely, above the resting rate you see one color, below the resting rate you see another color, then you get a phenomenon that is similar to simultaneous contrast, which I indicated with those two big polka dots, but you get a change not just in intensity, that is lightness, but also in quality, namely color. And here's a lovely example of that. Here you see a pale yellow X, here you see a mauve X, But actually, if you follow the arm of this mauve X and continue it down to the arm of that X, you actually see that they're both gray, the same shade of gray. But against a yellow background, that gray seems purple. Against a purple background, that is yellow. What we're seeing here is a combination of the first bit of wiring, lateral inhibition, where yellow here inhibits yellow here, purple here inhibits purple here. Combine that with opponent process, namely the relative rate of firing above or below the resting rate determines quality, and you get this simultaneous color illusion. Here's another example. Again, I got this as an email attachment, but this red over here and that red over there are the same. The difference is that these ones here are surrounded by four whites. These ones here are surrounded by four greens. They change in the shade of red, the hue that you experience. You should see this, depending on how the projector is calibrated, as more of a pure apple red. This is more of a purple, even though objectively they're the same. Okay, final bit of neurophysiology that I will explain. And this is called habituation. Namely, as a neuron fires a lot over a long period of time, it will drift back to its resting rate. It's almost as if the neuron gets tired. Now, that's not literally what happens, but it will, in response to sustained stimulation, the neuron will not keep firing its head off indefinitely. Eventually, it kind of, you can think of it as almost getting bored, and it will drift back down and no longer register what it has been registering so far. I mean, an intuitive example of that is when you walk into a room and it's got some smell, you notice it, you are in the room for half an hour or so and you no longer notice the smell. If you imagine yourself now being a neuron, you understand habituation. On a hot summer day, you start to wade into cold water, your feet experience rather unpleasant cold, then you stand there. You let your feet, as we say, habituate, and you no longer detect the temperature of the water. It feels like body temperature. Now you wade in another few inches. The part of the skin that is now suddenly exposed to water will now feel the cold until you habituate to that. Now, again, I'm going to ask you to combine two of the separate features of neurophysiology that I explained separately. Now combine habituation, the fact that neurons return to their resting rate, with opponent process circuitry, the fact that downstream neurons respond to, give rise to a perception that will be two poles of a continuum, depending on whether they are above or below their resting rate. And you get the perceptual phenomenon that we call an after effect. Here's the way it works. You show stimulus A for a long period of time until the A cells habituate. Then you show a neutral stimulus. Think of neutrality as meaning the following: equal amounts of stimulation from the A and the B. That could be the red and the green, the hot and the cold. What will happen? Well, when in an opponent process circuit, if it's getting equal input from two sources, but one of them has been habituated because you've seen it over and over and over again, the other one will then dominate the input. It will drive the opponent process circuit below its resting rate, and you will perceive the qualitatively opposite sensory quality. That is, the neutral stimulus will now be perceived as B, the opposite of the one that has been tuckered out by the repeated stimulation. This has been known literally for centuries. And if you go way back in the history of philosophy, I think it was Erasmus who first called into question our perception of the world by noting that our senses can fool us. And he used, my memory serves, as an example, temperature after effect, which works as follows. You can try this at home. Have a glass of cold water, have a glass of hot water, have a glass of tepid water. Dunk one finger in the cold water, one finger in the hot water. Leave them there for about a minute. Your fingers will habituate. Now you put them in the tepid water. the finger that will be in the cold water will perceive the tepid water as hot. The finger that was in the hot water will perceive the tepid water as cold. An amazing sensation. You can try it at home. Explanation is straightforward. If your sense of temperature depends not on your input from your warmth receptors, nor on the input from your cold receptors, but to the balance between them, opponent process, and you've got habituation, the hot inputs go back to normal as your finger sits in the hot water. Then when it gets a neutral stimulus, hot equals cold, the cold input is rested and ready and rarer to go. The hot input has been tuckered out, so what is a neutral stimulus, tepid, is perceived as cold because the balance of the input changes. Now I'm going to show you the same thing in color and in motion. Actually, before I put this on, what I want you to do is I'm going to show you a Union Jack in odd colors. I want you to stare dead center at the Union Jack, trying as hard as you can not to move your eyes until I tell you to. Okay, so fight the ordinary temptation to scan around the slide. Keep your eyes dead center in the middle of the Union Jack until I say so. So that is look right here, try not to move. Okay, I'm going to let a little bit of time elapse. Again, kind of go into a zen-like state or take control over your bodily processes and don't allow your eyes to drift all over the place. It doesn't matter what you're thinking. This takes place at a fairly low level of the neural system. You can daydream, fantasize all you want as long as you don't move your eyeballs. And when I'm going to count down to five, and when I say go, what I want you to do is move your eyes over to the, there's a black dot on the other side of the screen. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, look over here. It worked. See a nice jack in the right colors. But this is the kind of thing that you see in cereal boxes and Cracker Jack prizes and intros like textbooks for decades. But here's a much better one. This one again. By the way, perception psychologists often have tournaments to come up with the most dazzling, amazing, gobsmacking illusions that they can. This gets kind of boring after a couple of decades. The annual conference of vision researchers has a prize for the best new illusion. And I think the following one may have won one year. Spots, the color after image is no longer properly aligned with the contours of the object. So again, we'll do it one more time. Black and white. All of that, all those colors are triangles. Okay, now, so I've given you an example of a temperature after effect. I've given you an example of a color after effect. Now, it turns out that the brain processes motion also with opponent process circuitry, and moreover, the habituation applies, and here's the way it works. If you're, actually, maybe I'll show it to you and then I'll explain it. Oh no, I'm sorry, one more for color after effects. Look at the spot, the cross I mean. Now, do you see a, if you keep your eyes fixated at the cross, do you see a bright green spot spinning around and around? That bright green spot does not exist. It simply is the absence of purpleness moving around the circle, as you can confirm if you move your eyes away from the plus. But that, again, is another... Okay, now stare at the center of the spiral, please. Right here, try not to move your eyes at all. I'm going to bring the lights back for a second. Okay, so I'm... We used to have a cheesy science fiction television program in the United States called The Twilight Zone. I don't know if it was ever syndicated in the UK, but it always began with a spiral like that. So stare, stare, stare. Don't move your eyes away. Just look right here in the center. Okay, stare, stare, stare. Okay, now I'm going to count down. And what I simply want you to do after I finish counting down is just look back at me. In fact, just look, when I say go, just look at my nose, okay? Okay, so 10, 9, 8, 7, six, five, four, three, two, one. Now look at me. This is the great exploding head illusion. And it was, you don't need fancy technology to experience this illusion in everyday life. I actually encountered it by accident once when I was mountain biking in California. And as I was going along a trail, I suddenly reached the edge of a cliff and looked at the cliff on the other side of the ravine, and it seemed to be moving backward, backward. And I was just staring at it, trying to figure out what was going on. I thought, am I having an LSD flashback from the 60s? And then I realized I never took LSD in the 60s, so it couldn't be that. Then I realized that it hit me. It is a motion after effect, that I had spent about half an hour moving forward through dense forest with the leaves moving outward, 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 as the mountain bike was progressing. Then when I got to a neutral, non-moving stimulus, the cliff on the other side of the canyon, it looked like basically it was visually contracting, which is the opposite of the expansion from looking at the leaves. Contraction equals motion in depth, and so it looked like it was perpetually receding, but at the same time not going anywhere. An even earlier version of this was called the waterfall illusion, coming from the fact that if you stare at a waterfall for a period of time, then you look over at the rocks beside the waterfall, it'll look like they're drifting upward. They will be doing something that you might think is logically impossible, namely moving without changing position. Now that is impossible physically, but it is certainly possible psychologically. The explanation is the same as it is for temperature and for color. Namely, imagine that you have motion detectors that are wired into an opponent process circuit. So you've got let's restrict ourselves to one output cell. It's got a bunch of motion detectors for inward motion in toward the fovea that excite it. It's got a bunch of motion detectors for motion outward from the fovea, inhibiting it. If you have repeated stimulation of in, the inward motion detectors are habituated, the outward motion detectors are fresh and ready to go. You then have a neutral stimulus, say my face, equal amounts of inward and outward motion objectively, namely my face isn't doing anything, but because your inward motion detectors are habituated, your outward motion detectors are normal, the balance will be toward the outward motion detectors, and you see the great exploding head illusion. Now that was not the miracle, though, that I had in mind. Here comes the miracle. I clipped this out of a reputable publication in the United States called Weekly World News, and it is self-explanatory. I want you to look at this image for 1 minute, and a miracle will happen. I will count off the minute. Okay, look right in the center of the image. And again, I will count down. And when I say go, I want you to look at the white square, just as the Weekly World News headline instructs you to do. Okay, we'll wait. We'll give it the full. Miracles don't happen instantaneously, so you will have to wait for the minute to be up. But again, the better you prevent your eyes from drifting, the better the miracle will be. By the way, it is impossible to fixate your eyes perfectly still, and there is a good reason for that, which you could probably deduce based on everything that I've said so far. Namely, if you could ever prevent your eyes from moving, the world would disappear. For all of the reasons that I have just explained, namely, every part of your visual field would habituate. The fact that your eyes are constantly jittering, they are darting over the visual field, there's even a little bit of vibration, a little jitter in your eye, that prevents any, except in extraordinary circumstances, like some of the illusions that I've shown you, that would mean that habituation doesn't actually happen, the world does not go away. Okay, five, four, three, two, one, zero. That's my job. Yeah. So, I promised a miracle. says so right here. I have heard, by the way, that the internet has put the Weekly World News out of business, which I consider a great tragedy because many of my best slides, my lectures, come from headlines from the Weekly World News. So just to sum up some key points, I tried to explain to you how a phenomenon called neural firing works as the transmission of ions through channels across a neural membrane, then propagated across the length of an axon. How synaptic transmission works, a change from a fundamentally electrical kind of transmission to a chemical diffusion process. Feature detectors, how simple patterns in the world cause neurons to fire, representing them. Difference between local and distributed representations, the grandmother cell versus the patterns. Computation in neural networks, how wiring neurons together can compute simple logical functions like and, or, and not. And then properties of real neural networks that can explain large psychological effects, effects in your actual conscious experience. Lateral inhibition, opponent process circuitry, and habituation being three features of neural wiring and function, which give rise to the phenomena of simultaneous contrast, after effects, and Mach bands and other forms of contour enhancement. Thanks very much.